No, you're just full of surprises because there's something else you're awful good at.
I got too many hobbies. way too many hobbies. Yeah. My wife always told me I had too many hobbies.
I'm sure a lot of them say that, but I think that we definitely need to share with the folks some things that I think you're really good at, and that's painting.
Okay. Well, I appreciate it. I consider myself a talented amateur. When I was a teenager, I used to sit and watch my, I was about 12 or 13, I'd sit and watch my dad. Sometimes in the evenings he'd sit and paint. And he'd draw pictures or paint, you know, wildlife or people. He loved to do Indians and things. And I watched him one night and I got interest and I said, Daddy, can I do some painting? And he gave me some paints and brushes, an old piece of plywood. And a few days later, I had painted two mallard ducks coming off of a lake. And he looked at it and said, you can have my paints and brushes because you're better than I am at it. So I kind of got into painting for a little bit when I was a teenager. And I didn't paint much because I couldn't afford brushes or paints. And I kind of got out of it and went in the Army, you know, and went, got married. And then I was working at Monsanto at one time, and a guy over there painted, and I was looking at some of his paintings. And I told the guy I was working with, I said, well, I can paint that good. He said, you can? And I said, yeah. And he brought me a picture of a deer, a buck deer and a doe. And he said, can you paint that picture there for me? And a big, just like a little Christmas card. And I said, oh, yeah, I can paint that for you. And he said, well, you paint it, and I like it. I'll pay you whatever you want. About a week later, I brought his painting in. He said, how much you want for it? So I started painting again. I rediscovered my talent. And mostly it's wildlife. I do have some old farms. I love old farms, old fields. But most of it's wildlife. And
now you've got some specific paintings.
I do.
Of experiences you've had on ambush.
45 years of hunting, and my brother and I were... We hunted from dark to dark when we were off. We stayed on Manila Creek, which is Plymouth Amherst. I will say Manila Creek. Every time I say that, that's Plymouth Amherst. So we spent a lot of hours in the woods. And, of course, having this painting urge, a lot of things stuck in my memory. So a lot of times I'd do a painting. And if you've seen the shed antlers earlier, you'll know where the idea of this painting came from. I call it the old survivor. And he's just got out of his bed, and it's late in the year, or early part of January, February, March, whatever. And he's lost one of his antlers. And he's the old survivor. He survived many hunting seasons from the antler. He's a 10-pointer. He survived many hunting seasons. And I just, when I fought that one antler one time, I just come in my mind, here was an old survivor. And the top one is a buck laying there, and he's watching two hunters go up the point. Big trophy buck. And I'm sure that's happened to me many a times.
I'm gonna zoom in on that so they can get the... All your pictures tell a story, don't they?
Yeah.
They're not exactly as they seem. I'm going to zoom in on the two hunters that this big buck's watching.
Okay.
There they are. Look at that. Yeah. Lord knows how many times that scene's unfolded.
This was a real buck in southern West Virginia. I painted this off a photograph on an old West Virginia wildlife magazine. And if he'd have been killed when he had this rack, he'd have been a new state record. The guy, this article went on, and the guy did kill him about a year or so later, but he had declined because of his age. His rack had declined, and he didn't have quite the rack he had. But he used to photograph him coming out in the fields in the evenings before deer season started, and he'd photograph him. And he hunted him for several years there, and he finally got him with a bow.
I'm going to zoom in.
A guy bought this off of me. A gentleman I worked with bought this painting off of me. And about a year ago, I ran into him somewhere, and he said, I want you to have that painting back. And I said, why? I said, you paid me for that painting. He said, I know, but he said, it needs to be on your wall.
That's good stuff, man. There's lots more. Let's get to it.
This painting here is one of those old snowy days where the flakes come down big and wet and sends a lot of hunters home. But the smart hunter knows not to. He knows to stay there as long as he can take it. Before the snow melts and you get a little blue sky in the background, and this is a place on Amherst. It may not look like this now because of so much has been cut out with the gas company lines and stuff, but that was a place on Amherst.
Now, your stories always have more to them than meets the eye.
Well, I was in a place like this. I just wished I'd have seen him, but I never seen him. But
you've got a hunter in there, don't you?
Yeah, there is a hunter sitting here. The hunter's facing away from the deer. The deer's got his nose up, sniffing the air. And I like to leave whoever the viewer of the painting to wonder, will the hunter see the deer first, or will the deer see him first, or will he smell him first? If the deer smells him first, the game's over. But I always like to have like a little story in the painting. Okay, there's some old strip mines down on Plymouth Amherst. Of course, most of them's grown up now, and some of them you can't get to because they were on private property. But this is a bobcat. He's sitting above his den hole on a rock in the sun. The first bobcat I seen down there was in the snow. And I had got off midnight shift and decided I wanted to go grouse hunting at the old strip mine. And it was one of them nights where you got a little light snow, maybe a quarter of an inch, and it got kind of cold, probably 15 degrees. Well, I jumped in my truck as soon as I got off of work at 7 o'clock in the morning and went down to the grouse hunt for a few hours. As I was walking around one of the old strip mines, the rock walls on the strip mines, when they cut the roads around them, was maybe 10, 12 feet high over your head. I was going around one of the strip mines, I seen the big cat tracks. I could tell they was cat tracks because you couldn't see any claw marks in them. You know, a cat retracts their claws. And I said, man, that's a big cat. And a little bit of snow hit me on the shoulder, and I looked up, and there was a bobcat on the rock ledge above me. Must have been right outside his den, sitting in that morning sun. The sun had just come up, and I guess he was trying to get warmed up. And I guess when he seen me, he made it move to jump up, and he kicked some snow down on me, and he went in his den. But that's how that idea for that painting came from. But I did it in the fall without the snow. This one is a couple of gray foxes. I've got one standing guard while the other one sleeps, and I believe that's the way they do most of the time. And I was in the woods. It was late December. I was bow hunting, and back then they didn't have all the gun seasons they have now. So in December, after gun season was over, you had a week of muzzleloader, and after that you could bow hunt without blaze orange. So it was late December, I still had a bow tag, and I was sitting on an old log and watching a cove, and I caught a little, and there was a light snow on, probably a couple inches, 2 or 3 inches, and I caught a movement off to my right, and I hadn't moved any, and I seen a gray fox coming, and there was a huge log. I changed the painting a little bit, but the idea was the same. And this gray fox that came down that big log, and it stopped, and then behind it came another one. I guess they mate for life, you know, probably. And the lead one laid down, went in a circle about three times like a dog, and laid down and took its big tail and covered its nose, I guess to keep it get warm. And when it did that, the other one just stood beside of it and sat on the log and stood guard. And after about a half an hour, I was freezing to death. I wanted to move. My feet was getting cold. This one got up, and then that one, the other one laid down. But I guess I didn't know that at the time. You learn things in nature by watching. But I guess one of them always stood guard while the other one took a little nap. So that's where that idea came for that painting. But I got them laying on an old fence, an old door off an old fence. And there's the old, there's the hinge where the doors broke off. And where the sun's melted part of the snow off of it, I got them laying, sitting on it, taking a break. An old farm in the background. This is an actual place on Manila Creek, and I love spring turkey hunt. And I painted this one like the sun's coming up over the ridge. It's just hitting the tops of the trees in the spring. The leaves haven't come out yet, early turkey season. And this is an old field, and it's still there on Manila Creek, and it's got a fence. But of course, it's, you know, you don't want to hunt on a farmer's field. So I'm over here, and these are public land woods on Manila Creek. And I've got the hunter sitting here, and this actually happened. This was me. And I'm trying to get that old Tom to to cross that fence and come over there in the woods so I can shoot it. But what eventually happened, he did come over, but he came up, and I thought, sure, he came up the fence line towards the call. And I've always heard that if you called a mile away from a hole in the ground, a tom turkey could come and look right down in at you. That's how well they can pinpoint where a call's coming from. And he came up the fence line, and I thought, sure, he was going to see me. But finally, he came under the fence, just enough over through the fence there for me to eat turkey. So that is an actual place on Manila Creek. This is a scene from my early turkey hunting experiences on Manila Creek or Plymouth Amherst. Back then, when I was a young man just getting into turkey hunting, I thought you could sneak up on a roosted turkey when he was gobbling in the morning. It took me a lot of crawling up hills and muddy clothes and stuff to realize that they just wait for you to get right almost in range and fly off. But this is a scene, an old slip on the hill, which you get a lot of them down there, and turkeys don't care where they roost as long as they like it. And here I got the sun coming up, hitting the back side of the tree, and I call this pain perilous perch. Got two old gobblers sitting on the limb getting ready to fly down, and it's, you hope that they're going to come down where you're at. Okay, this is my idea of the perfect turkey morning. The old Tom, he's come off his tree. He's got him a spot where he's going to gobble. The sun's just coming up, clearing out, and the sky's clearing up. Trees are starting to glow orange from the sun. And it's just a feeling when you hear that first gobble that just raises the hair up on the back of your neck, and you hope you're in the right spot. This pain here, it's just something that every deer hunter dreams about seeing. It's early morning mist. Huge buck, maybe 6, 7, 8 years old. He's been around forever. His hair's a little bit wet from the mist and fog that's been out that morning. And this is just accumulative thoughts in my head as I sit down there at Plymouth Amherst bow hunting on them cool, foggy mornings in the mist, hoping that the big monarch comes out.
Now, I've been quiet this whole time with these pictures, but I have got to zoom in on the bottom where these leaves are spilling out. It is absolutely amazing, in my opinion. Just absolutely beautiful. I mean, look at that. To me, I mean, that's why I'm here, man. One of the reasons. Look at that. This is beautiful. Great work, Snakespit.
Thank you. Dave, you like to go by the nickname Waiting for Fall. Well, if the collars in this painting don't get your heart racing, ain't nothing going to do it.
That's gorgeous. I love it.
But
what's the story behind this?
Well, probably 10, 15 years ago, I was bow hunting, slipping through the woods, early October, a lot of leaves, especially the maples, you know, turning brilliant colors. I seen two bucks sparring. They wasn't this huge, but I like to put big antlers on bucks. But they sparred with each other probably for 45 minutes, and me, I'm trying to slip in range, you know, because I'm a ground hunter and I'm slipping around. Never could get in range either one of them. They sparred around for each other, and then they both separated. And I thought, well, they're going to go in different directions, but they didn't go probably 20 yards, and both of them bedded down. Just laid there and looked at each other, resting, waiting for the next attack. But I doubt if either one of them, they're both about the same size, so I doubt if either one of them dominated the other that day. They're just more or less practicing. And there was a couple old broken rub trees, you know, that they had. But I set this scene up here I just thought, man, what a scene to walk into. If I walked into a scene like that, I probably wouldn't even think to draw my bow back.
Why is that?
Just the collars, the beautiful collar. I'd just be standing there in awe.
Sometimes it ain't about killing, is it?
Nope. If it was about killing, I'd have quit a long time ago.
Amen, bro. You're giving me chills. I love it. Awesome.
This is a photograph of a rock that's on Plymouth Amherst. And I found it years and years ago, and as far as I know, I'm the only one that knows where it's at. I've never told anybody else about it. And if you don't know where it's at, you'll walk right by it. And it has the initials EO carved in the rock, and beside that is 1875. That was carved in there about 120 years ago.
That was after the Civil War.
130 years ago, just probably about 10 or 11 years after the Civil War.
My.
And whose initials they are, I have no idea. And on the point above this rock, I was bow hunting. The same, well, not the same day, maybe another day. But I sat down on a rock to eat a snack, because I used to bow hunt all day long if I was off. And the rock I sat on, I just leaned over, and it had carvings on the front of it. And it was a rock about the size of an Ottoman stool, like you would have in front of a chair. And I have never went to look for that rock again, because back then the only thing I was interested in was deer hunting.
Yeah.
But about a year or two later, I found this rock, and that made me want to go hunt the other rock up. But I've never went and looked for other rock yet, but I do plan on taking Dave, because I want somebody besides me before I die to know where this rock's at.
Well, I'm honored that I'm the guy.
I'll take Dave and show him this rock and let him go up there and run his fingers over that carving.
I can't imagine. That's going to be awesome.